Right, let's get started. Eric, great to have you here over in Europe. I know you're here a lot.
Yes.
I don't think there's one startup out there, actually, that wouldn't like to emulate in some way Alphabet's rise. You're frowning already.
No, no. Go ahead.
But when I ask people about Alphabet, they go, oh, you mean Google. Something that categorizes the internet, key focus advertising. What do you want them to think when they think, see Alphabet?
Well, of course, Google is this fantastic company that everybody here uses, and of course, its letter is G. What we did when we created Alphabet as the parent company is we created a place where we could create other companies, which would have different letters, of course, A through Z. And of course, the CEOs of these companies are called characters, as in the alphabet. So we have a whole bunch of them. The most interesting ones recently are DeepMind, which of course is our AI work in King's Cross, and then a life sciences company called Verily, with others coming.
I want to take you back over the last 5 to 10 years, because if we look at what are their key trends today, mobile, video, you are positioning yourselves. You bought YouTube. We've seen the spread of Android. Given that you just mentioned DeepMind, I wonder if I already know where you're going to go, but what's the investment today for the next 5 to 10 years? What's the driver?
The dominant sort of model in computer architecture today is smartphones connected by fast networks to cloud computing. And we've spent 5 to 10 years here in Europe and elsewhere saying that's the model. And we were right, right? So today people are using either Android or iPhones. They have these incredibly powerful networks in the developed world. And the cloud computing services are phenomenal. And each and every one of the startups represented here are fundamentally using that as their paradigm. So the question is, when you've built that, what do you do next? And the answer is you apply machine learning. And machine learning comes out in all sorts of ways. The simplest example is that you can use classifiers for images. And so, for example, computer vision is better than human vision. And so you can imagine lots of startups where, like, the doctor looks at your skin. Well, I'd rather have somebody take a photograph of my skin, tell the dermatologist what it is, and have he or she tell me if I'm okay or not. Because the computer vision is better than human vision. That's an example of a simple rule that will be true for many, many years.
So break it down for me. Let's fast forward 5 years. What's your revenue stream? Advertising, cloud services, AI, some kind of human learning, virtual reality? Well, what dominates?
Well, I've been at Google and Alphabet now for 15 years, and it's always been advertising. And I suspect it will always be advertising, because advertising is such a large part of the global phenomena, and because our advertising is more accurate, that is a return on investment, more precise advertising, and I think that what we'll do is our tools will get better and better at getting the right ad for you in the right place in these new architectures. Now, we're obviously going to have growth in these other areas, but the advertising space is so large, and our advertising system, if I may brag, is so good in terms of delivering the right ad that I think it'll remain so.
So talk to me about artificial intelligence, because in your conference last week, this was a real buzzword. Yeah. I know a number of headlines saying you're doubling down on AI. How do you monetize it?
Well, in our case, we already use it a little bit, because the machine learning systems that we build are trained against, for example, advertising.
Yeah.
So our advertising systems use earlier versions of what is the right ad for this scenario. And because Google is essentially a large amount of data, it's also a large amount of training data. And a little bit of the language for everybody in the room if you're not familiar with it. The AI and machine learning systems work when you have an awful lot of training data, so you can say, this is what you do here, this is what you do there. And if there's relatively sparse data, the systems are not able to learn. And we have lots and lots of clicks and ads and people doing things on their phones and in apps and on YouTube that we can use to train to produce better services. And that's why we keep talking about this, and why the Google I/O conference, it was such a feature of everything we did.
We just assume at this moment, I think, that artificial intelligence is a positive for society. But at what point do you think the regulators step in here and go, hang on a second, how is this being used and how is data and information being collected? You know a thing or two about regulators, particularly here in Europe.
Well, there's two different questions there. The AI and machine learning work that's being done in the industry, not just at Google, although I'd argue we're certainly one of the leaders, is not anywhere near what you see in the movies. So I constantly encounter people saying, well, when will HAL take over, referring to the movie? And I say, well, how many movies have you seen of this kind? And the answer is, for their whole lives. And we're not at the point, and we're not likely at the point anytime soon, where those kinds of issues would even arise, let alone require regulation. There are certainly concerns among governments today about data retention, data policy, and so forth and so on, and we work hard on that. But we're a long way from those issues, I think.
Define a long way.
Oh, a decade or more. A long time, not 1 or 2 years.
That's not long.
In our world, that's infinitely long.
But it's not long if you're talking about...
Well, in our world, it's a long time.
Yeah, it's infinite, I get it.
In our world, a lot of things can happen in 10 years. If you think about, just as an aside, 10 years ago when we started pushing for entrepreneurship in Europe in particular, there were essentially no startups to speak of. And today we have significant billion-dollar corporations here in Europe. We have quite the momentum. We have this conference as an example. There are lots of areas where we and other companies have invested significantly in trying to help create this ecosystem. The app ecosystem itself creates opportunities for each and every one of you, independent of us. Yeah. There's just a long list of things that have changed in a decade, and it will be true for the next 10 as well.
You've opened up your intellectual property on AI. I mean, Tesla's done similar with their technology and understanding. What's the logic here? What's the economics?
Well, part of our job is to seed markets with new ideas. And the quickest way to do that is to build software, which is called open source, where you literally freely license it. We built a library called TensorFlow. And without getting too much into the technology behind it, the machine learning algorithms that we're talking about are essentially matrix multiplication. And multidimensional matrices are called tensors. So TensorFlow is a library that allows you to take these matrices and manipulate them. And in addition to TensorFlow, we've also introduced some simple libraries so that you can see how these vision recognition and other kinds of models would work. We're trying to seed the market. We believe that not only will we be using TensorFlow as the basis of our products, but all of our competitors will and all the new startups. And on balance, that's a win. Because we win when the whole ecosystem gets larger. There's more knowledge, there's more sharing. It's always been true in tech. People have this sort of simple book model of us versus them. But part of the reason that Silicon Valley has been so successful is that there is a broad array of collaboration at the technological level, which has lifted the infrastructure up, whether it's at the networking level or the platform level or the language level, and that needs to continue.
So use that example in the court case. We're waiting for a verdict today between yourselves and Oracle, and the ongoing dispute that we've seen here with Java. What happens if you lose today?
Well, of course, we're part of the open source movement, so I think it really hurts Oracle because they own Java and they need to promote it into this new world, and it just doesn't make sense to me that they're in that path.
What about for startups who've tried to make their products compliant? Aren't we opening a whole host
well,
of potential lawsuits
there?
Well, there
is now an open source version of all of this, which they can use, and I would recommend that.
Alphabet's got huge resources, talent, great tech. Why have you struggled in social?
Well, we've been doing other things to start with, and the things that we've done have had they haven't been exactly targeted in the way people think they are. So we try to build identity management systems, which we can then use to make our other services better. We have a slightly different objective. We'll see how this next generation works.
So explain Allo and Duo to me, because a lot of people out there are saying, why do we now have 4 chat products? Where's that centralized plan to tackle Facebook?
Well, perhaps because Allo is better than anything else on the market. It was announced this week.
I know.
Before we sort of criticize it, why don't you use it? That's sort of my attitude. The product is quite good. What's interesting about Allo is that it uses our machine learning to be smarter. And so I spend all day saying, why don't we just take products and add intelligence and make humans smarter? Right? If you just sort of stay that as your goal throughout the entire product line, and again, this is the opportunity for machine learning. So in Allo's case, it's just come out. Let's use it for a while and see if it really does deliver particularly good. It has a system which helps you answer questions and understands what's going on. It's never been done before in the messaging space.
Okay, guys, get involved. Put your hand up if you use Instagram, Skype, WhatsApp, iMessage. Okay? So keep your hands up. Put your hand down if you'd be willing to switch to something that's maybe a bit superior, or you're stuck using what you're using. Do you like what you're using? Interesting.
So
there's potential.
Yes, it turns out if you make a better product, people switch to it. It's a shock, right? By the way, I think every person in this room actually believes that their product that they're building is better than the current ones. Otherwise, they wouldn't be building their startup.
There has to be a mentality of that. You have to continue to innovate.
It's called being an entrepreneur.
How many new ideas really are there? Or are they not just a new idea of an idea of an idea?
If I follow the line of reasoning, there are no new ideas. Go home.
That was
a joke.
They're an adaption.
Okay, so let's just review again the truth of the world.
Yeah.
There are a gazillion new ideas in each and anybody's heads. We have a model for entrepreneurship. This market is the most open a market that there's ever been. What the internet has done is it has given voices to people who could never be heard before. They could never actually not only be successful, but be heard at all. Right, so the thing that I'm proudest of is that the connectivity of the world, and especially of the developing world, has given these people voices, not just for information, but also for their creativity, and now for apps and so forth. The fact of the matter is, I'll pick an example. Look at WeChat in China. Mm. Who would have thought that Chinese, we always decry their software and so forth and so on, they produced a very effective product for the Chinese market. It's doing very well, has more than 600 million users. So my point here is that if you look at it, it is possible, and every generation of young people, young entrepreneurs and so forth, believes they can do it, and some pull it off. And give you another shock. We have here represented on the stage Apple, Google Alphabet, Uber, and others. There's going to be more. In fact, there's going to be more because of scaling and the scale of the world. And that's why it's so exciting to be here.
I love that you mentioned China there. How does Alphabet improve its relationship with China? Is it still a plan, an option?
We're working on it. I think our role in China is largely determined not by us, but by what the Chinese government will allow. We left China in 2010 because we were uncomfortable with their laws, which have not gotten better since we left.
So if we look at the time since you've been away, we've gone from 50 million mobile users to 750 million. Yeah. And the Chinese consumers, quite specific, they seem to know exactly what they want. I mean, we look at chats, Tencent's years ahead of us.
What my Chinese friends say is that what they want is Google. That our competitor, and indeed we still operate in China, but we operate under these restrictions, which make it very difficult to use Google search, which is sort of a whole disaster. But people are heavily criticizing Baidu now. You can read about this in the Chinese press, and perhaps that's an opportunity we'll see. But it's completely determined not by us, but by the Chinese government.
Can you envisage a situation where consumers turn the government? The demand.
There is always hope.
But it's small.
There's always hope.
Talk to me about X, or Google X, because I watched a TED talk on this and it was quite fascinating. It was going back to this idea of tackling a project. Be optimistic about your idea, but at the same time, wake up every morning and say, how can I kill it? Search for those weaknesses and make it okay to fail.
Well, Google X, and now known as X, was designed by Larry and Sergey to try to address problems where it's a 10 times better gain. Something has happened in the last few years which makes it possible. It affects a huge population, and there's a consensus that it's now possible to solve that problem. So, for example, our initial AI work came out of Google X. All of the self-driving car work has come out of Google X. Much of the Google Life Sciences work came out of X. So the model works. And so the way to state it is that at any given point, there's a set of classic problems that have not been solved, but there's a problem or two where the technology, the investment society, there's sort of a consensus that with a concerted push, what we call moonshots, a real push, investment and attack it, we can make significant gains. For example, the Google balloons, which are floating around the southern hemisphere. I said it'll never work. Of course, thank goodness they didn't listen to me. This is a box that has an LTE signal from the satellite all the way, sorry, the balloon, all the way to the ground that provides LTE signals in rural parts of the world. It's a game changer for those people.
How do you choose? How do you choose an idea? How do you choose where to invest?
It's a consensus building process. You have scientists who are irrepressible and overconfident and sure. You have business people who check the assumptions and say, does this make any sense? And you have a lot of experience, especially in the form of our founders who've done this their whole professional lives.
What don't you want to hear from these guys?
Don't want to hear from?
Yeah, from someone who's pitching you. What don't you want to hear? Everyone asks what you do. What don't you want to hear?
I want to hear that everybody is focused on this new architecture. And anybody who's coming in with plans based on the earlier architectures, you're not going to make it. You need to be on scalable plans that solve real problems. It's so easy to solve a local problem, you need to dream bigger. Over and over again, we hear ideas that are interesting in a local context, but they're not big enough. Mm-hmm. So dream bigger, right? As a general statement about society, we need to ask the harder questions and we need to ask for stronger solutions. There is a global emerging consensus around issues and so forth. Together, we're very strong.
Talk to me about the European Venture Fund, because you had one, it then got combined into a global venture fund.
It turns out it was more operational to have a global fund, which is around $500 million, which is investing globally. And we're beginning that process. It takes a decade to get these funds going at full blast. We've made a number of investments. The rate of increasing investments that we see largely in Northern Europe is very exciting. And the other area where there's a lot of growth has been in Israel.
Let's not talk about rate of increase. Let's talk about magnitude. Out of 300 plus investments,
it's about 10. It's on the order of 10.
What are we getting wrong?
Well, I think it just takes time. I mean, there's lots of issues in Europe that have to get addressed.
What?
Well, let's start with the universities in Europe. We hire the incredibly smart people that come out of the European universities. The universities themselves are underfunded relative to the American universities by a lot, right? There are a gazillion laws that still make it difficult to be an entrepreneur, right? It's much harder to be an entrepreneur in Europe than it is in America. But the regulatory, the tax policies, the amount of time that it takes to create a firm and so forth and so on. What happens when I meet with governments is they all say yes, and they listen very politely. They're always very nice. Europeans are always very polite. And then they don't do anything about it. So if you want to do something, I mean, I'm serious, right? There is a model for entrepreneurship. It requires risk capital, serious investments in the universities, and then sort of tolerating the crazy ideas of the young people coming out of it, giving them some seed funding and letting them do it, right? And getting out of their way. That model works. It's produced this extraordinary wealth in America. It is repeatable in Europe, without question.
You're basically saying we're all talk and no action.
Well, those are your words, but the fact that, and you're starting, right? But the fact of the matter is, we hire thousands and thousands of Europeans because they don't have startups that they would go to, right? And these are the phenomenal engineers working for Google in Europe. I think Europe would benefit by having more and more of this. Now, we've seen a big change in the last few years, but it's taking too long. Right. It's time to accelerate this.
I think it's interesting that you're coming into Europe, you're looking at specific countries and going, actually, what can we tackle here? Yeah. When at the same time, you're facing quite a fierce backlash from the regulators over competition issues. I want to do a quick survey, get the audience involved again.
Uh-oh.
Hand up if you use an iPhone. What do you think of that, Eric?
So much for the Android monopoly in Europe. I think we made our point.
I think we did. But what
I didn't quite expect that, but I mean, I would have given you a different answer.
Let's do it the other way. No. Android phones?
Okay.
Eric, you should have two hands up, because I saw you using an iPhone earlier.
So we're clear. I have a Samsung S7 and an iPhone 6S, and the Samsung S7 is better. It has a better battery, and it has a better camera.
No pitching.
We're clear? So we're clear? Are we clear? And those of you who are iPhone users, I'm right.
But what happens if they rule against you here again and they say, hey, here's a fine, which actually doesn't look that too much if I compare it against your cash flow, but if they say you've got to do something to tackle their perceived complaints over competition, what do you do and how does that impact your business?
I mean, we respectfully disagree with these findings. In the case of the search case, which is really about product search, from my perspective, it seems to me that they're ignoring the enormous success of Amazon, right, in their analysis. And I think the survey we did of the audience illustrates the Android point better than I could ever comment on it.
I want to quickly wrap up by asking you a politics question. Donald Trump said data is overrated, among other things, of course. He said Obama got himself elected. It wasn't down to data analytics. What do you think, Eric?
Let us start by saying with Donald Trump that his candidacy has largely been fueled by Twitter, last time of which I checked was a tech company that used a lot of data.
What kind of president do you think he'll be?
Are you asking me if he's going to be president?
No, I'm asking you what kind of president you think he would make.
As a general rule, presidents have a lot of constraints on them.
You know, that's a good thing. Do you think he'll be president?
The polling there's a problem in America and perhaps here in Europe that the polling is based on home phones and it's difficult to do polling against mobile phones, and everybody I know uses a mobile phone. So there's some evidence that the polling is systematically inaccurate. But I think it's too soon to tell. Mr. Trump is busy unifying the Republican Party after his bruising battle with them. And I think it's too soon to tell. It's just too early to tell. We'll know in the fall.
It's no secret that you back a startup that's looking at data analytics to help Hillary Clinton. Do you think actually data can trump Trump?
I'm not going to make any predictions. What I will tell you about politics, and again, this may or may not be, each country in Europe is different with respect, but in America, it's possible to use data analytics to understand voter preferences and to encourage them to get more educated about both the threat of the other guy and the benefits of the current female candidate.
I've had my fair share, guys. I'm going to open it up to questions. If you can keep your questions really short, that would be great. No pitches. We've done for pitches today. Yeah, please.
Could you state your name, please? I'll hold the mic.
Marshall Bruisma. I'm from Peak Value. What do you think will be the big game changer in the upcoming 5 years? Will it be, for example, Google Glass or something?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear the last half because of the echo.
You said Google Home. Google Home?
You had Google Glass. So will we see Google Glass back or something? What will be?
Will we see Google Glass back? We're actually working on new ideas in that space, which are not quite ready yet. We like the space a lot. As you know, Google Glass was really an experiment, needed some work, and this is how Google works. So I think you'll see more of that kind of thing, and also much more augmented reality, where, again, the virtual reality stuff we do will be augmented with additional information that makes it more powerful. We're also very interested in voice. We've now had huge breakthroughs in voice, something like 20% of the uses of our Android stuff is now voice-based, and we think we can get that significantly. So we're very interested in eyes, ears, voice, communications, and exploring that across all of our products.
All right, next question.
Hello, my name is Hetty Geinsman. I'm one of the co-founders of Actual. We aim to revolutionize the building industry via 3D printing. You recently said that you really foresee a very important opportunity for 3D printing in the building industry. Can you please elaborate on that?
We have a strange echo, so you'll have to say
what
it.
What are the chances for 3D printing?
What are the chances of 3D printing?
In the building industry.
Of buildings.
Yes.
There's a huge phenomenon around 3D buildings of printing now. And the reason I want to highlight this, and thank you for your question, is that we take for granted that the building stock in Europe and America is largely built. But especially in the developing world, the ability to 3D print literally floors quickly of renewable and recyclable material is a huge breakthrough to lower the cost of housing. And in the last 20 years, we've taken people who are at a dollar a day to sort of lower middle class. Their next problem is quality housing, and we can solve it with 3D construction.
All right, next question. Your name, sir?
I'm Hossein Maudi. I'm from Tunisia. We're here with the Tunisian delegation, and I wanted to ask you, now that the Middle East and North Africa startup scene is booming,
yes,
and we saw you closing your offices in Egypt and in Tunisia, what is your future plans for this region?
We moved the offices around for various internal reasons, but I don't know if you know, but I was one of the first executives to go to Tunisia and met with startup, with the whole startup scene at the time, and they were all doing Android development. And what I particularly liked, which is always good, so what I liked about it was the sort of people who were the bloggers as part of the revolution were also the technology thinkers who then created the new startup scene. So there's no particular correlate with opening and closing offices. We're very supportive.
All right, next question here in the middle.
Hi, my name is Pieter Christian van Oranje. I have a question. What is your vision on agriculture mechanization?
So the first comment I would make is I think that there's evidence that there's new science in turning plants into meat and milk products. And so think of it as there's a set of startups that are around essentially synthetic food. And here, of course, it's a wealthy area. People have very high quality food. But there's evidence that these new techniques can reduce our reliance on cattle. And cattle are major contributors of global warming. This also helps us with dealing with the over-farming that goes on. There are machine learning and AI techniques that are now being used to more accurately both water and also de-weed farming areas. And those are all net positive for better farm utilization, fewer pesticides, better water conservation, and better human health.
One last question here.
Hi, my name is Bert-Jan Ter Kate. We do yield management for websites, and we use one of your products. And as a startup, our main issues are keeping focus and make sure that our cash flow is okay. Well, your cash flow is okay, but if you have 5 chat apps, like Alo and your Google Hangouts, how do you choose to keep focus on which chatter?
Yeah. So me, I'm using Allo.
Yeah.
Because I always try to use the one that's actually the strongest and most powerful one.
I understand, yeah. but that's you as a person. Now you as a company. So you have 5 products throughout the world. Everybody's using a part of them. So how does a company like you?
Well, it depends on how well they work. But assuming Allo does very well, the others can be integrated into that effort over time. It's somehow people have made this into a big deal. It's not. We're trying to do things that are new. As they become more successful, it's easy to integrate the others into the winning product.
Is it a significant challenge to Facebook? Are you in what you've got here? Or is that not the point?
No. Well, first place, I hope it's not the point. But the big companies spend all of our time partnering and competing. And so I'm sure that 6 months from now, they'll do something, and then we'll do another, and so forth and so on. The same is true of Apple and Amazon and so forth. It's always been true. Again, there's always this focus on bilateral competition. It's better to understand these as large companies which are innovative in different architectures, which are each trying to serve their customers and do things in a different way. And that competition produces enormous value, right, to you as consumers.
Awesome. Eric Schmidt.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Great. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.